In this video, I'm going to discuss rule number one from ASME, or American Society of Mechanical Engineers, Y14.5, geometric dimensioning and tolerancing. Some of you may have heard of this rule before, some of you may have no idea what I'm talking about, but it's a foundational topic in GD&T. So there's really only two rules, what we would call rules in GD&T. There used to be more, there used to be about five in the 80s, but they've whittled it down to two. The rest of the standard, which is, you know, about 200 something pages, or, you know, guidelines, there's a lot of shall or, you know, should do this, but this is called a rule. And because it's called a rule and everything else in the standard isn't called a rule, we should give it some weight, right? It's very important. And what it's going to do is give us a relationship between the size and the form of a feature. So very simply, if I have, say, this marker, right, and I measure all the diameters, I can get a size. I can figure out, you know, the value of the diameter. But I might also want to know how straight this marker is, right? If I open a box of markers and they're all bent, I'd be upset. Right? So form can have a lot of different variations. It could be the form, you know, straightness. How straight is it? How circular is it? A combination would be cylindricity, straightness, and circularity, and some other stuff. And then flatness wouldn't really apply here, but that's a form tolerance we have in GD&T as well. Now, size is a little strange, right? We have different sizes. We've got a local size, which is a 2-point measurement. So if I measure right here where the arrows are, I'll know what the diameter at that spot is. But we know that all cylinders aren't homogeneous, right? As far as the size goes or the diameter goes. So we could have a situation like this, right? What's going on here? Well, we have two sizes. So the question is, okay, so if somebody asks me what's the diameter of this cylinder, and let me make it more clear, right, center line in the right view. Somebody asks what's the diameter of that cylinder, you could give them two values, right? You know, whatever is best for your situation. Is it this larger one or is it here? Rule number one is going to fix, you know, some of these questions we have. The answer to this one is yes, there's a local size. And then there's what we might call an envelope size. So what do I mean by envelope size? Well, if we got a similar cylinder, right, so a perfect cylinder, and kind of collapsed onto this, we'd find out, you know, the minimum mating size of this cylinder, right? So what I mean is we want to know what's the maximum space this could take up. That collapsing feature would get us there. I'm getting a little ahead. That's further on in, you know, GD&T type stuff, but we're gonna kind of show something very similar in a second. All right, so what's the example I'm gonna give here? This is an attempt at a very simple drawing, right? So we've got, you know, a format, title block, I'll call this a pen, and all I really need is two dimensions for this pen, right? Diameter, length, and I've given it as metric. So we're 30 millimeters plus or minus 2 with a length of 150 millimeters plus or minus 4. So we send this off to get made, right? Shop comes back and say they're bent, right? Maybe not bent this much, but you know, they're clearly bent. Something went wrong because we didn't tell them how to make it, right? Maybe they went and bought some tube, right? And just cut it to length. But turns out the tube they got was already bent, and they were hoping if they cut it short enough, you wouldn't notice, but you do notice, right? So it's bent. So the question is, okay, how do we prove, right, that we should get this part when in actuality we're presented with this part, right? Well, make a long story short, there's nothing on this drawing that requires this pin to be straight. Now, I'll say this drawing with just this information, just these two dimensions. You might say, well, most drawings have general tolerances near the title block. And you might say, well, there's always like, you know, like angles plus or minus 1 degree. Like, doesn't that help? It depends, right? The angles plus or minus 1 degree, unless you have a very detailed note or company procedure, I could put a very small protractor at any of these corners and it'd be pretty close to the 90 degrees, right? It depends the length you're checking, right? So if I put a protractor over this whole length, right, obviously it'll give me the correct reading, but I don't know if they're gonna do that. It depends what they have. There's no GD&T requirement for that, right? Eventually, there is perpendicularity and ways to control orientation, but not by default with this plus or minus business. Okay, real quick, if it's an ISO drawing, right, there'd need to be something on here. The system they use is to default to kind of a shared doc, if you will. It's called ISO 2768, there's -1 and -2, and I think there's an even newer version with like a different number. I'm probably 10 years behind with ISO. But essentially, it's a general tolerance or a title block tolerance that everybody in ISO can use, which is pretty neat. So you would specify, hey, we're going to ISO 2768. Here is the tolerance class, right? So you'd say, hey, this is a rough or fine or medium or whatever. And based on these numbers, you go pick out from a chart what the form is supposed to be. That's one way of doing it. In the Y14.5 system, we don't do that. In the US, normally you make up your own title block, right? That's your company's decision to have the title block however you want it. So the way we invoke Y14.5 to avoid this situation is somewhere in the drawing, normally near the title block, but it could be in the notes, is to say, hey, we're in accordance with, or interpret this in accordance with, or whatever wording you want to use, ASME Y14.5 and the year you're using. Rule number one doesn't change that much, but you know, your company should know what year they're using. You don't want to just leave it blank. So what does it do? Essentially, it's going to combine the size and the form, right? They're going to be kind of locked together. So the definition of rule number one, the paraphrase definition of rule number one is that any dimensioned regular feature of size must have perfect form at the maximum material condition. What's maximum material condition? Maximum material condition is a condition in which the feature has the most material. For an external feature, like a pin or a tab or a width, it's going to be when it's at its largest size. So in this case, the MMC of our pin is 30 millimeters plus 2 millimeters, so 32 millimeters is our maximum material condition size. There are other places we use MMC, right? For instance, this symbol. I'll put a card up for a video where I discuss that in more detail. But for now, it's enough to remember the phrase, we have to have perfect form at maximum material condition. Now, we're going to not require perfect form at other material conditions. And I'll show you in chart form what that means. Now, if you go check Y14.5, the definition is way longer. I'm really trying to shorten it down so to help you understand what's really going on. So what I want to show next is this handy chart. Okay. I'll read the definition in a minute, but I want to show the chart first. I think it's easier to understand. We've got to have perfect form at this maximum material condition, 32 millimeters in our case. Right. So if the form is perfect, we're going to allow zero form variation, right? Which means that this pin needs to come out perfect, right? A perfect cylinder. Now I'll explain how we check it in a minute, but perfect cylinder. Now, when the feature departs from the maximum material condition, we're gonna get form tolerance equal to that difference. So on the chart, if we come in 1 millimeter smaller than the maximum material condition, we get 1 millimeter a form variation, okay? And we just keep going down. 2, 3, 4. Right, to check your work, the maximum form variation is gonna be equal to your total size tolerance. So the tolerance is 4 millimeters. The maximum form variation we can have is 4 millimeters, but only if any local size is 28 millimeters. So the check for this is a two-part ordeal. We're gonna check that LMC size to make sure we're not violating limits of size. And then we're going to do what's known as an envelope check or a boundary of perfect form check by making sure that our cylinder can fit through a perfect cylinder set at this size. Let me show you on the board. So on the board, I've attempted to draw a gauge. So when I say gauge, I just mean, imagine a donut, right? It's got a cylinder drilled through it. So we've just got, you know, a cylindrical part with a hole going through it. The only thing that matters is this hole, right? So I'm saying it's 32 millimeters, and we're just gonna take it for granted, right, that it's perfect, right? Say it's a precision gauge, it's 32 millimeters. We're just gonna go with that as a kind of theoretical discussion. In real life, right, this would have a tolerance, but we won't worry about it for now. So this is gonna be set to the MMC of that feature, of that cylinder. Now we can't violate that boundary, but we can come in under it. So say we check a cylinder, it's 32 millimeters everywhere we measure it. It's gotta fit in this gauge, right? If it comes in at 32 millimeters and it's bent even a little, it won't fit through a hole of 32 millimeters. And this is convenient. This makes it like a functional check, okay? Now, if our supposed cylinder here comes in, right, it's got a dent in it, right, or some kind of form variation, as long as we're not undersized, so as long as this is less or greater than 28, the other side of the least material condition, as we would call it, and it fits through the gauge, we're all good, right? In fact, this form variation doesn't really get reported, right? As long as it fits through the gauge, that's the form requirement. The only thing we have to do is make sure it's not too small, right? By checking it in a couple spots. It's a pretty cool, convenient way to do it, right? You could do it with hand tools, you could do it with a CMM. It doesn't literally have to be a gauge like this, right? So you imagine a granite plate and you have this cylinder, you can set your height gauge to 32 millimeters off of the table and just roll the cylinder around, right? As long as it doesn't bump up any, that's your perfect form check, right? So again, it doesn't have to be a custom gauge, right? You could approximate pretty well on a CMM, surface plate, a couple different ways to do it. And this is gonna be the default requirement in Y14.5. So when you call it out on the drawing, you say, hey, we're using ASME Y14.5-2009, 2018, whatever, this comes along with it, right? If you don't want rule number one, and before I go into that, rule number one, if I make this much, much smaller, right? So 1 micron, it's not only gonna make the size smaller, it's going to evaporate. It's gonna evaporate our form tolerance as well, or I mean, vaporize our form tolerance. And I changed it from 1 to 2 just because it fits my chart better. But this is our total size tolerance, 4 microns. 4 microns is the maximum form we can have. So while it protects, you know, parts from being bent, right? It does bind that size and form together, which isn't always what you want. If you don't want rule number one to apply, you can put the independency symbol next to the dimension. And what that does is override rule number one and let you control the form separately with a straightness tolerance or cylindricity, circularity, however you want to do it. But again, that's how you override it. There's a couple exceptions to rule number one I won't get into in this video. Hopefully this was helpful. Last time I made a video about rule number one was, I don't know, in 2020 or something. So it's very important. If you have an interview that covers GD&T, they probably will ask about it. The key phrase is perfect form at MMC, or maximum material condition. If you can remember that, I think you can, you know, kind of remember this chart, fill it out, and you'll be good to go. So that's it for this video. If you enjoyed it, please like and subscribe. Leave a comment down below.